Hello, I'm Daniel Morris, Chief Market Strategist, and I'm here with Maya Bhandari, Global Head of Multi-Asset, to share with you our market outlook. We're used to market volatility. For example, we look at the VIX for the equity markets. More recently, the MOVE index for fixed income has become more important. And unusually, the MOVE index volatility has been higher than the VIX. And of course, normally we think of equity markets as more volatile. I'd argue we also have a new kind of volatility, if you will, narrative volatility, as we try to explain, if you will, what's going on in the economy, what's going on in the markets. And we seem to have moved through, I'd say, four key themes over the last months or quarters. Number one, what we would like to see is a soft landing, a reduction in inflation would be nice, but perhaps not particularly likely. We worry about actually probably more recession or a hard landing. At times, we seem to have renewed overheating and increased inflationary pressures, or the alternative perhaps is stagflation with slower growth, but still high inflation. And in fact, we've seen at some point, it seems, each one of those at some time. How is your view of how things have evolved over the last few months?
So over the last few months, Dan, I would say already fat tails to the distribution of expected growth outcomes in 2023 have actually fattened further still. And as you alluded to, markets have swung through all four quadrants of our investment clock in a few short months, rather than over a period of several years. Now, currently, as you also reflected, markets seem to have settled on a very clear narrative of global economic recession as being the most probable outcome everywhere. And frankly, we're less confident, even if we don't entirely disagree. So, for example, the recent turmoil in the banking sector highlights just how important regional banks are in the U.S. economy, and indeed how a further tightening of lending there is a real and tangible downside risk to U.S. growth. But it's less clear to us when we look elsewhere, in EM Asia or indeed Europe, where the growth, inflation, policy and banking sector dynamics are all very distinct. And so I would put to you that we have much more confidence today around inflation being stickier in parts of the world, like Europe, for example, around regional decoupling, with EM Asia looking stronger than other parts of the world, than we do on the precise growth outcome for this year. And that's both in terms of the depth and in terms of the timing of any prospective recession.
Given that volatile environment, let's talk a little bit about asset allocation. Now, equities have outperformed fixed income for the most part so far this year. And perhaps surprisingly, given that you talked about everyone seems to be expecting a recession at some point. Nonetheless, if we look at the activity data now, we see, of course, that for the most part, growth is still pretty good, particularly in Europe with the latest PMI data. And of course, inflation's high, but that's not necessarily such a bad thing for equities. How have you managed all this volatility that we've had, this move through the quadrants that you've mentioned, in terms of your own asset allocation?
So perhaps I'll answer that, Dan, through the lens of some of the changes we've made in asset allocation portfolios really since the period from mid-March onwards. So first, following really big moves in bond markets on news of Silicon Valley and Signature Bank, and then on UBS and Credit Suisse, we went short European duration. We were really seeking to capture, I would say, sharp valuation dislocations around concerns on the banking sector and contagion thereof that seemed overdone, particularly in Europe, where banks are, of course, much more regulated, and particularly following the very sizable policy responses. Now, we already had a more cautious view on European duration, and that really has been driven by the trajectory of inflation, which is sticky and has yet to peak, and a more hawkish ECB. The moves we saw on what I call a Black Monday gave us the opportunity to crystallize these views, which we have deepened as opportunities have presented themselves. Second, we've taken a partial profit on our long position in European investment grade credit. And again, here, seeking to take advantage of sharply tighter spreads or valuations, essentially. At 150, 155 basis points in spread terms on the European IG index, we are a long way from the sort of 230 levels at which we were leaning in last September. So that's the second change we've made. Third, we've neutralized our position in U.S. equities, given downside risk to U.S. growth and earnings, where regional banks, as I reflected a moment ago, are really quite important. And we've moved this allocation instead to EM Asian equities, which we continue to favor on both valuation and fundamental grounds. I should say that we stay firmly neutral on equities overall, and our short is concentrated in European equities. And last but not least, we reset the funding leg more recently of our long Japanese yen position from euros to Swiss francs. Now, we continue to favor being long Japanese yen on both fundamental and valuation grounds. We think the currency should benefit meaningfully from an expected shift in Bank of Japan policy and an end to yield curve control. It's a far more liquid way of reflecting this view than, for example, JGBs. And funding this in Swiss francs is also preferable from a risk reward and a portfolio construction perspective. I should add that as a result of these three or four key moves, our overall risk-taking in multi-asset portfolios has moved up a risk quintile from dislike into neutral, and that's the first time we've been in this quintile since last April.
You mentioned European equities. Now, frankly, I think it's safe to say it's been one of the surprises, or the performance of the European equity market, one of the surprises over the last year, particularly when we think about how negative sentiment was, of course, when Russia invaded Ukraine. What's gone better, perhaps, certainly on the price of commodities, energy prices falling much more quickly than expected, thanks to a mild winter, conservation efforts among companies and households. Also, we probably need to recall that last year was the reopening year, if you will, for Europe. So we had a lot of very good momentum for economic growth. That was last year, though. When you look at how European equities appear versus other potential investments within the equity space, how does it stack up?
So we've been short European equities for nearly a year, today held relative to an overweight in emerging Asia within broad equity neutrality overall. And although this is working very, very recently, I think it's fair to say that this has been a painful trade for us to hold. So why do we stick to our guns? Well, simply put, returns across asset classes are really driven by two things, your movements or expected movements in cash flows and the discount rate that you apply to those cash flows, bringing them back to today. And both discount rates and cash flows are moving, in our view, against European equities this year. So starting with cash flows or earnings, we see clear downside risks given simply how high expectations have risen in Europe in contrast to most, if not all, other markets. European earnings expectations are also far above their own trend, suggesting any slowdown in growth could have a disproportionate impact here. I should say as well, we see the opposite today in Asia, where too much caution is baked in to prices. So very much supportive, if you will, of that relative value position. We also see upside risks to discount rates that are applied to those cash flows. With stickier inflation, particularly in core inflation, but also in wages, plus expansionary fiscal policy in the Eurozone, we see greater upside risks to discount rates here, as I alluded to when we were talking about our duration views earlier on. And I should say that EM Asia and China are in a very different position. They are, of course, easing. And more broadly, emerging market central banks were ahead of developed markets in hiking interest rates. And so, in our view, have more room to ease as and when they need to. And last but not least, Dan, Europe has relatively high cyclical gearing. And the global cycle, as we discussed at the top of our session, is looking weaker. Being long of China and EM equities is, in our view, a better way to play for the strength that these regions might bring to this relatively bleak global landscape than playing this view in Europe.
Thank you very much, Maya.
Thank you.
Well, that's it for our update this quarter. Thanks for watching. Please do join us next time. And until then, take care.